Hi everyone. So when most people think of climate change denial, we think of right-wingers who don't see climate change as a real threat to civilization. They once denied that it was happening at all, but I think the fact that global temperatures are rising is undeniable at this point. But there is a form of climate change denial that is much more insidious because it masquerades as a solution to climate change. And it's endorsed by liberals with these signs in their yards. People who claim to believe in science, like unnatural vegan. What I'm talking about is the concept of green growth. Our current economic system requires a growth rate of 2-3%, otherwise we plunge into a recession. In other words, the growth imperative is central to capitalism. The idea that we can solve the climate crisis while maintaining a capitalist economy is called green growth. This idea that we can continue growing the economy indefinitely using renewable energy is a fantasy. This video was inspired by Jason Hickel's book, Less is More: How Degrowth Will Save the World. I highly recommend reading it. Let's start with the science that green growthers won't outright deny. The IPCC released a comprehensive report, and its conclusion made headlines. In order to prevent ecological collapse, we need to stay below 1.5 degrees Celsius of warming, 2 degrees max. Globally, we need to reach net zero by 2050, which means high-income countries need to reach net zero by 2030. Here's where proponents of green growth start to deny reality. It is impossible to shift to 100% renewable energy and grow the economy at the same time in such a narrow time frame. Currently, clean energy isn't slowly replacing dirty energy, it's being added on top of it. And our energy demands are increasing faster than our capacity to roll out renewables. But let's ignore this time constraint for the sake of argument. Let's say we began this project 20 years ago. Would green growth have been possible in this scenario? Certainly, we could have transitioned to renewable energy by now and maintained economic growth. But what would the future look like? Could we sustain the growth rate necessary for capitalism to function? The answer is no, because viewing climate change as simply a matter of emissions rather than extraction is misguided. It's not just the type of energy we're using that's the problem, it's what we're using it for. Ecological breakdown is not happening solely as a result of direct emissions. It is happening as a result of deforestation, mining, overfishing, and general unsustainable resource consumption, as well as the emissions that come from such activities. If green energy is used to power endless extraction and production, it's not so green after all. Solar panels, wind turbines, and nuclear power plants all require the extraction of resources. Mining is a big driver of deforestation and biodiversity loss. Of course, compared to fossil fuels, the impact is much lower. But which is worse? Burning fossil fuels to power an economy a tenth of our current size? Or using renewable energy to power an economy 100 times our current size? The point is, there are limits to growth. Operating under the growth imperative, green energy companies could become as savage and destructive as fossil fuel companies, trashing ecosystems, lobbying against environmental regulations, and buying off politicians. But what about recycling? Can't we just have a circular economy where we recycle everything? Unfortunately, most materials cannot be recycled. We may think the plastic we toss in the recycling bin is getting recycled, but in reality, it's downcycled. This means it cannot be recycled indefinitely, as the quality breaks down during the recycling process. Plastic is a capitalist's best friend because it's super lightweight, making items much cheaper to ship. Returning to glass and aluminum in the interest of creating a circular economy goes against the logic of capitalism, as it would set us back in terms of growth. What about services? Can't we just switch from a material-based economy to a service-based economy? Yeah, one major problem with that. Services require material inputs. Tourism, one of the most resource-intensive activities, is classified as a service. Evidence showing that the economies of developed nations are dematerializing can be chalked up to an illusion of accounting. The domestic material consumption of several rich countries has gone down while GDP has continued to go up, leading people to believe that GDP is decoupling from resource use. But domestic material consumption factors in the products they purchased, but not the materials that went into those products. When you factor in all of the materials, the results tell a very different story. There has been no such decoupling. GDP directly correlates with material resource use. What about technology? One idea that has been floated as the solution to climate change is bioenergy with carbon capture and storage. This negative emissions technology would theoretically allow us to overshoot our carbon budget because we could just suck carbon out of the atmosphere and bury it in the ground. It's a cool concept, but the scientist who invented it did not intend for it to be used at the scale capitalists are banking on. It would have to compete with agriculture for land and water, and we have limited fertile land and freshwater reserves. Considering these factors, this technology is only capable of tackling 1% of emissions. And geoengineering schemes like solar radiation management are extremely risky, as they would likely create problems as big as the ones they aim to fix. Another problem with relying on technology to solve our problems is that throughout the entire history of capitalism, technology has enabled us to expand production and thus consume more. Improvements in efficiency could have freed up more time for workers, but instead, gains were funneled towards expansion. Rather than produce the same amount of stuff in less time, capitalists demanded that workers produce more stuff in the same amount of time. This is what the growth imperative calls for: more, more, more. Our appliances may be greener than they used to be, but is it green to have 2 homes and 3 refrigerators? With the demands of our current economic system, believing that technological innovation will lead to decoupling is magical thinking. The growth imperative actually reduces efficiency, as it encourages businesses to employ shady strategies such as planned obsolescence. Stuff is essentially designed for the dump, meaning it is made to become obsolete relatively quickly so that consumers must replace items more often. Think charging ports that change every few years, rendering old chargers useless. Although we have the technological capacity to design products to last much longer, devices such as phones and laptops begin to malfunction after a few years. Appliances are cheaper to replace than fix because they're designed to be incredibly difficult to repair. And then there's perceived obsolescence deployed in advertising. Fast fashion brands push ideas of what is trendy and what is out of style to manipulate people into buying more and more to keep up. This is absolute insanity, but this is the result of a system that produces stuff for its exchange value rather than its use value. Efforts to limit advertising and ban planned obsolescence run counter to the logic of capitalism. They stifle growth. If proponents of green growth were genuine, then they wouldn't oppose the idea of putting a cap on annual resource use and waste, and tightening that cap each year until we're back within the planetary bounds. They would welcome the opportunity to prove skeptics wrong. But of course, you won't see people like Bill Gates supporting such policies. Why not? If this decoupling of GDP from material use is already happening, and the theory of green growth is sound, then capping material use shouldn't pose a threat to growth. To quote Jason Hickel, if we're willing to imagine speculative sci-fi fairy tales to keep the existing economy chugging along, why not just imagine a different kind of economy altogether? And what if, instead of trying to decouple GDP from resource use, we could decouple human progress from GDP? We take it as an article of faith that growth benefits humanity as a whole, that it is essential for human progress. GDP is a flawed measure of human progress. For one, it was never intended to measure human progress. The economist who introduced GDP warned against it being used as such, saying the welfare of a nation can scarcely be inferred from a measure of national income. Goals for more growth should specify more growth of what and for what. GDP tallies up all monetized activities, good or bad. War and environmental destruction increase GDP. Yet non-monetized labor such as cooking, cleaning, gardening, and childcare are not accounted for unless, of course, you pay someone else to do these things for you. GDP only correlates with well-being up to a certain point, and then the relationship breaks down as there are diminishing returns to growth. In other words, the social and ecological costs cancel out the gains. Data shows that it is possible to achieve high levels of human welfare without high levels of GDP. Only around $10,000 per capita is needed for quality education and healthcare, high life expectancy, and overall life satisfaction. The global average is $11,300, which means there are only gains to be made from degrowth. But what about jobs? Get ready to have your minds blown. Capitalism functions off artificial scarcity. There is no scarcity of resources to meet everyone's needs. A third of the food we produce is wasted. There are more vacant homes than homeless people. Scarcity is created and maintained by capitalists so they can continue raking in profit. Think about it. Growth requires perpetual need. So the goal of a growth-oriented economy is not to satisfy everyone's needs. It is to avoid satisfying people's needs. In a capitalist framework, degrowth would cause mass unemployment, triggering a recession. But if you remove this framework and get rid of the growth imperative altogether, it becomes evident that the scarcity of jobs is also artificial. As I mentioned earlier, technological advancement could have reduced people's work hours, yet instead, savings were invested into ramping up production. There is a simple solution here. Shorten the work week. Then there would be no crisis of unemployment. In a capitalist framework, cutting people's hours would cause mayhem as incomes would fall. But again, we're throwing out that restrictive framework. I said cut hours, not pay. We don't want handouts, we want what is rightfully ours. Because as the data shows, almost all of the wealth created over the past several decades has gone to the top. It has made the rich richer, despite the fact that it was the working class who created that wealth. The great thing about a shortened work week is that it delivers multiple benefits to society. Reduced unemployment, greater life satisfaction, and a lower environmental footprint. It turns out, when people have more time off, they gravitate towards lower impact activities such as exercising, socializing, and volunteering. With little time off, people engage in energy-intensive behaviors such as retail therapy, high-speed travel, takeout, and meal delivery services. Unnecessarily long work hours leave people with little time to cook and clean and watch their kids, so they resort to paying others for these services. A shorter work week reveals that our scarcity of time is also artificial. To paraphrase Jason Hickel, if scarcity is created for the sake of growth, then by revealing artificial scarcities and removing them, we can render growth unnecessary. In 2017, the United Nations Environment Program reversed its position on green growth as the science became clear. It's a pipe dream. Those who promote the fantasy of green growth are engaging in a form of climate change denialism. Right-wingers deny the overwhelming evidence that climate change is happening and is caused by human activity. Green growthers deny the overwhelming evidence that the climate crisis is being driven by capitalism. I can't help but think of a Christian friend of mine who accepted the scientific consensus regarding the age of the Earth and understood the concept of natural selection, but didn't accept the theory of evolution. She believed that the Earth was 4 billion years old, and she believed in microevolution, yet she rejected macroevolution. Apply the theory of microevolution to the timescale of 4 billion years, and you get macroevolution. It's the same thing at play here. People claim to believe the science regarding climate change and accept each premise on its own. For example, capitalism requires growth. Growth increases energy demand. Renewable energy requires resource extraction. And we live on a finite planet. Yet they reject the conclusion that follows when you add all of those premises together. Proponents of green growth are desperately trying to fit a square peg in a round hole. Stop trying to make green growth happen. It's not going to happen. Thank you so much for watching. Please give this video a thumbs up and comment down below. And as always, stay tuned for next week. All right, peace out. Yo, how when me eat, them I wonder when me eat. When me tell them, say me no eat no fish, nah, no meat now. How when me eat, them I wonder when me yum. When me tell them, say that I'm a vegan man. How when me eat, them I wonder when me eat.